Hi, fam. It's the Sabbath, and it's time for some of my Sabbath sentiments, as I like to call it, when I have things on my mind and I want to share, and it's the Sabbath day. I like to call this my Sabbath sentiments. And I'm making this video as a precursor to a video that I'm going to share on my page. You guys know that I have been sharing stuff that's different from when I was a Christian, when I was calling myself a Christian and I was in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, right? So I've been sharing things that are outside of that box for the past 7 years. So this is my 7th year anniversary in biblical facts. That's what I'm going to call it, living in biblical facts, right? And the gentleman that I study under, his name is Elder Ricard. He is the head of the GOCC, which is the Gathering of Christ Church, right? And it's not about him. It's not about, you know, me. It's about the Most High God, his truth in the Bible. And it's about the lies that Satan has just embedded in us. We're like embedded with falsehoods from the time we are born, right? And so I wanted to talk about that a little bit. I've talked about these things several times, but I wanted to do more of a little heart-to-heart thing this time with you all, because I want you all to understand that I know where you what you feel, and I know where you're coming from. When you hear certain things and you reject it, I'm you, you are me. I've been there, done that. And I want to start off by saying the name Israelites, it tend to scare people. It tends to scare people because a lot of us have come across rogue groups of Israelites who spout such hatred and evil from their mouths. And it's so unchristlike that whatever truth it is that they have to share, we're not trying to hear it because they sound insane, right? Something that we're not used to hearing. They're harsh and they're militant, right? It's nothing wrong with being militant for Christ, mind you, but for Christ, that's the part. And they were not Christ-like in their behavior, even their language. They use a lot of foul language. A lot of them use a lot of foul language, and it's a turnoff. So if they have something to share, who's going to listen to it if it's being presented that way? It's ugly, right? So we're not attracted to ugly. That's why in Christianity, we are attracted to it, because it's a pretty little package, pretty package of lies. But anyway, let's go back to the beginning. I just want to share a time with you when I was downtown Brooklyn and I came across some Israelite brothers who I never even heard of this, I don't want to call it a movement, because it's not a movement, it's an awakening, right? And even though people in the beginning of this awakening was coming too hard with it, too harsh with it, and it was a lot of things that they still didn't know, learning the truth about yourself, it made you feel a little more confident about sharing things with the world. But it also got a lot of them guys in a cocky headspace where they felt that they were better than the other races of people, right? The other cultures, other people, right? They thought they were better. And so when they were sharing information, they were doing it in a degrading way. And it came off so poorly that people were standing. I remember people arguing with them. I also remember people standing there listening too, because when they made certain points and certain references about the color of Christ, which a lot of us have said, myself included, I don't care what color he is. If he got on his cross for me and he died for me, that's good enough for me. I don't care if he could be purple, you know? And those are the silly things we say when we don't have any knowledge about something. We say those things because it wasn't about his appearance to us at the time, right? We were just thinking about the character of Christ. And so any man, whatever background and culture he was from, who can come and save us and be that type of person, of course we were attracted to that beauty, the beauty in him. So the outside aesthetics were not important to us. So coming up, we always saw pictures of a white Christ. Every book I remember opening up, all the way down to a little friend in Sabbath school when I was a little child, every picture I seen of Christ was of a white man. Even the angels that were in pictures, when they used to put those little things on the board to teach us in Sabbath school, they were white. most of the people were white with colored people thrown in. You would see a black, maybe an Arab Indian looking type person, Asian. They would throw us in, but mainly everything was whitewashed, right? And so you grow up so blind that you don't even question that. And I'm not going to say everybody, because there's a lot of people I've come across in these 7 years that I've learned what I've learned. I've come across people who say, since I was a little boy, I always thought that was weird. Or a person would say, since I was a little girl, I always thought that was odd. I didn't. So I was definitely brainwashed. So this is why I wanted to come and speak to you all. And I wanted you to just kind of feel my heart a little bit, because I don't want you to feel like, oh my goodness, Kenya done got mixed up in some kind of cult, or she's nuts or whatever. And if you feel that way, that's fine. I can't tell you how to feel, you know. I just want you to know I'm not your enemy. I'm your sister. We have one common enemy, one major enemy in common, and that is Satan. And what he did was deceive the entire world. And we are all a part of this entire world. So we've all been deceived. And what we should be trying to do is to figure out how. And so I just want to share a couple of things that I picked up on in this journey of mine, right? Seeing those guys on the street cussing, and they were literally, and I was like, wow, these guys are nuts. They were literally pointing in white people's faces as they walked by. They were like, you, you're going to hell. Yeah, you, I'm talking to you, you're going to hell. Telling people they were going to hell. And I was definitely amazed by that, because I'm like, is no way that they can judge that by looking at a person and saying that they're gonna, and condemning them to hell. You don't know that person. Like, yeah, my boo was calling. He's in the middle of my, trying to record here. Let me see, did I send it? Okay. Hopefully he'll understand. I get back to him, because this is important, right? So as I was saying, they were literally condemning people to hell as if they had the authority. So they were really cocky and nutty. And I was like, no. So I'm be all over the place a little bit, y'all, because I'm kind of excited and I'm trying to make this as short as possible. This is the 7th year anniversary of my awakening, right? This is also the 7th year anniversary of me and my boo. My husband, yes, our 7th anniversary as well. And when I got, because he and I had met before 7 years ago, I actually have known him now. I'm 54. I was 40 when I actually met him, and he was 41, right? So I've known him for years, but it was 7 years ago that we actually reconnected. And that's another story for another time on a YouTube page, right? YouTube platform. But right now, I just want to try to help you guys relate to me a little bit, because I want to share something with you. And I really would love for you guys to just watch this video, because I guarantee you, you are going to be mind blown if you've never heard these things before. And if you're Christian or Islamic, you have not heard these things in where you go to worship or go to learn. I know that for a fact. I was a Christian, right? And so when Moses and I got reacquainted, it was around the time that I was questioning everything. I'm like, Lord, what's wrong? Like, what's going on with me? I felt, I didn't feel whole. I felt incomplete. That's the word. I like that one. Incomplete. I felt incomplete. I started to get antsy. And the first thing the Holy Spirit, I felt the Holy Spirit say to me was, first of all, you're not in my word enough. You're not in my word enough. I was reading the Bible like I'm pleasing the Lord. Like, oh, let me read a couple of scriptures here. Da, 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 da. With no understanding or whatever. Just reading. But I wasn't in it enough, and I wasn't spending enough prayer time with him. And so I said, maybe it's just because of that, that I'm feeling this way. But it was more. It was so much more. It was a time for me to graduate spiritually and become awakened about to the things that I had no knowledge of, and the things that we were taught all our lives and always enjoyed and we were accustomed to. It was time for me to come out of that. It was time for the Lord to graduate me, because he had a desire to use my voice. And I've always thought it would just be in singing. You know, I thought that was my ministry. I had no idea that I would get to this point where I would be this bold to share something like this with family, friends, and even strangers on this level, right? And I don't have a whole bunch of followers or nothing like that, but I have enough of you to share a message with, and if only one person in the bunch comes to the knowledge of truth, my job is done. Because we all have a purpose, right? And we can all reach the people within our circles, right? And so this has been a lovely journey. And I'm going to say in the beginning, it was kind of difficult because you almost feel lonely because you're doing something that's so different. People begin to think something is wrong with you. And especially when after meeting a man and dealing with a man and he introduces you to this stuff, it's like, oh, she done lost her mind. She met this guy and this guy got her crazy. And it was even said that I was using drugs. Me, who don't even take an Advil for a headache. Yeah, that was even said, but we're not even going to get into that because that's not important. But I just want to show you how people feel when you start to do something different and they're not accustomed to seeing you behave in a certain way or speaking or acting a certain way. It's so different to them. And I get it. I get it. And that's why I wanted to do this, because I wanted to get you guys to see that we are the same. We're all in this fight together. We are all struggling with things. We all find it hard to do something new because we're so accustomed and comfortable in lies. We are. And I wanted to just say, Easter is tomorrow, so I thought it would be important to do a video in reference to that. Like I said, a precursor video to the one I would like for you guys to watch. I'm not a teacher. I'm a sharer. I'm your sister. I'm a servant of God. Period. Point blank. Period. Right? And so this is what I want to do. I just want to kind of open you guys up a little bit to thinking sensibly. Let's talk about Easter right quick. First of all, I want to speak to my Adventist audience, because a lot of you are my heart. That's my fam, my Adventist fam. I grew up in Adventism. I've been in the church around my church family for years, right? So there's no way I could not love you. I had all my great experiences in this church amongst these people. Even though the religion itself was not of God, there were godly people who loved the Lord who just did not know, who influenced my life greatly, have been encouraging to me, have prayed for me, and has encouraged me in my ministry, have been thoughtful of me when if I wasn't at church, they would call me, see how I'm doing, helped my daughter when she was away at school. So there's no way I can disregard that. I would not be Christ-like to not remember and recall the wonderful things and experiences that I have with you all in the church, right? So because I was in the church, I remember a lot of things that were going on in the church. And I just want to talk about Easter. Once upon a time when I was a little girl, we were not even celebrating holidays in the Adventist church, right? So something happened along the way, right? Things always get watered down when we're not based in truth. It gets watered down. And I wanted to point that out. I don't even remember us having a Christmas concert, New Year's prayer and fast, Easter. We didn't do these Thanksgiving. We didn't even talk about this stuff when I was a little girl. And I grew up in Brooklyn Temple Church, East New York as well, with my grandma Jackson. These are the two churches my grandmothers had gone to. And so I can't even recall in my mind we doing anything like that when I was that young, right? But then somehow it came to be, and I don't even remember when. So now we are doing the same thing that we used to talk about the first day churches now, mind you. And this is not to provoke a war between anybody, because it's already out there. We already fight against each other because we are in different religions, as if we are the makers of those religions. Like, we ourselves came up with it, and we have the audacity to be offended about something that existed before we were even here. So let's think a little logically. I'm on tired tongue because I'm excited. Y'all excuse me. Let's think a little logically, right? All of these things were going down before any of us were even born. We just got caught up and swept up into it, right? So now it's time for us to use the brain that the Most High God has blessed us with and think a little logically instead of thinking about the traditions that we grew up in without any question. We never questioned them, right? So what I wanted to get to was that in Adventism, we started paying attention to Easter. We even started having Easter programs. A lot of us even joined the Sunday churches to be a part of the ministry. Sure did. And we did these things knowing that Sunday was not the Sabbath. We knew what day the Sabbath was. We did have that correct, right? So then why are we not participating in the worship service of the sun god? Because that's what we were taught, and that is the truth, is the sun god worship, right, on Sunday. We're participating in these things now because we're thinking, oh, we could be kind to them. They're our brothers and sisters, which they are. Indeed, they are. But we tend to want to acclimate ourselves to things that the Most High God do not want us to acclimate ourselves to for keeping the peace sake. But we don't care if we have the wrath of God come pouring down on us because we just want to be sisterly and brotherly to other people that are doing things outside of what we believe was correct in God's eye. We knew this stuff, but we did that, right? So I just want us to look at that. And Sunday worshipers, a lot of them make excuses. And I'm not talking about the worshipers. Forgive me, people. Please forgive me. I'm talking about those who are running the churches. They tend to put out stuff that they were taught in theologian schools, or maybe if they didn't even go to a school, it was regurgitated from the times we were young and we hear these things repeatedly, right? And so we just repeat them over and over, and this is how things get passed down to the next generation, right? Curses. We can pass down blessings and we can pass down curses, right? And I guess we've done a little of both, but thank God for his mercy and grace and winking on our ignorance because he knew that we didn't know certain things. But there are those who are leading our churches who have an idea about what's going on. And because they don't want to lose their parishioners, because when you tell the truth, you're going to lose people. That's just a fact. People don't like the truth. We want things sugar-coated and we want things to be sweetly and nicely done. We don't want to hear about the possibility of busting hell wide open. We don't want to hear about damnation. We want to know about finances and how to have a peaceful life, as if this is all there is, right? And so we just got caught up under these silver-tongued devils standing in the pulpit lying to us, right? What in the world does the resurrection of Christ have to do with bunnies and eggs? What, family? What? And we already know who runs the show. The mother church, the great whore, is the Catholic Church. And if you're a Catholic, I'm not offending you personally. Don't take this message personally, family. We came into this mess. The mess has already been here. We came into it. This is not your personal fight, okay? Your personal fight is individual with you. Your journey is personal with the Lord. So it's time for us to attend to that, to focus on that, and not be offended because of some ridiculous religion, because that's what they are. So back to what I'm trying to say. The Catholic Church, they're the mother whore, right? And all the churches fall under her. Even Adventism, we don't, you know, go to church on a Sunday, but everything falls under them, from the Trinity and this picture of this Caucasian man put in our churches, even in our homes, on the walls. All of this stuff comes from them and so much more. I'm trying not to go too deep because it's just too much right now. And I don't want this to be too long because I'm prepping you for something else. We have to understand that we have been lied to and recognize and start to open up our eyes. And what happened with me, because I felt like I was sinking instead of growing spiritually, that was why I was ready to receive the truth, because I knew something was missing. Something was missing and I knew it. I just couldn't put my finger on it because I had already believed that I was in the right place. And it was probably based on just because we kept the Sabbath. I didn't look into the other things that we were doing that had nothing to do with the Bible. And celebrating these holidays just became a part of our church. And the leaders and pastors no longer said, oh, we shouldn't do this stuff, it's worldly. And I remember my grandmothers telling us this. I would go want to buy them a gift. And they were like, girl, don't buy me no gift. It's just materialism and the merchants trying to make money. All these things are biblical. But the churches somehow fell at the wayside. And they just going with the world. But because the Catholics are above everybody, above, they're the mother church, they're setting the tone for everything. And they just outright said they have the authority to change the Sabbath. The Most High God, Creator, gave us the Sabbath, but they have the authority to change it. And so we're going into a church on a Sunday and we're worshiping on the day that the Lord did not ordain or hallow, right? For us to worship on and to remember. And then now Sunday Easter comes, and even those who are Sabbath keepers are joining in and participating in all these activities that come with this Easter thing and the other holidays as well, Thanksgiving and Christmas and this New Year's thing. We have been consumed, and the Bible talks about drunkenness. We are drunk spiritually because we're just going to and fro, don't know what to do. I was listening to a woman say how she went from all these different religions searching because she just, something was just not there. And it was beautiful that she discovered that she was not going to find it in a religion, because religions are incomplete. You can only be complete in the truth, and the truth is in the word. And so we think because these churches are using the Bible, claiming to base their beliefs on the Bible, but not actually following it. And we're just blind to that because we're just so accustomed to sitting down in the building that we're familiar with the people who we love and are familiar with. And a lot of us want to be accepted, right? And so we just do things to be a part of. But my God, family, we will be a part of a bunch of people burning in hell if we don't do our due diligence and figure some things out. I say this. If Christ did not do it, don't do it. Be safe. If you're not reading in scripture that Christ celebrated his own birthday, why are we celebrating his birthday or our own? If you didn't see in scripture that the Lord celebrated Thanksgiving, a new year, what are these? Oh, Easter. He didn't even tell the disciples, I'm going to die. I'm going to give my life. But when I am resurrected, I want you guys to remember that always, and just to keep that up. And every year around the time that I was resurrected, to just celebrate my resurrection. He never, ever, you will not find a scripture at all with the Most High God's Son saying to do this. There's no scripture that the Most High God himself told us to do these things. So if Christ himself is not doing these things, did not do these things, family, we should not. And whatever he did do, we need to do. Whatever he did, we should be copying and mimicking him, walking in his footsteps. That's what this whole journey is supposed to be about, right? But we're just falling off the path. The path is here, and we just look to the left, look to the right, and just falling off the path. Now, a lot of us have never heard this stuff before, because some of the times I share stuff, people go, wow, thanks for sharing that. I never heard that. And it could be one or two people. I don't get many likes. I don't care. It ain't about me. I'm not your God. I'm your sister. I'm in the same boat you are in, right? And somebody came to me and tapped me on the shoulder, so that's my job. Now I'm tapping people on the shoulder. That's what I like to call it, right? And so even if you don't trust what I'm saying and you don't accept what I'm saying, I'm hoping that while you're listening to me, that the Holy Spirit will do her job, because she is a she. That's a whole other story. That's a whole other story. I hope and pray that she's doing her job and she's nudging your heart a little bit for you to look into things. And when you open up your Bible to ask the Holy Spirit to give you some discernment, cry out unto the Lord. I want to know the truth, Father. There's just too many so-called truths in this earth. Everybody has a truth. or their truth, but there's only one. And the Bible says that the Lord is the truth, right? The Messiah who gave his life, he's our truth. He's it. We need to follow him to the letter. If he's not doing these things, we should not be, family. We should not be. And it's just, that right there is just blatant. That should be the obvious thing. Christ did this, so I'm going to do this. Christ didn't do this, so I'm not going to do that. That should be like black and white. There's no confusion there. The confusion came in with us being trained a certain way, right? And so if anybody steps outside of that or speaks against that, automatically, oh my gosh, she done lost her mind. He's crazy. He's bugging out. Oh my goodness, somebody done got to him, right? But think about whatever that person is doing. Is it in alignment with the scripture? Because maybe they know what they're doing. Maybe they showing us something different to do. We should actually be following the scripture. We should actually be following Christ. And just because I came across a crazy group of Israelite gentlemen on the street going in on people, and some of them were going in on us women too, us black women, us Israelite women as well. I mean, they had a lot of truth to say about it too, but it's just a way that you do things to get people to listen to you, right? When Moses came to me and he said, I have a video I want you to look at. And he asked me, why do I go to church? What do I get out of it? I automatically got my back up, family. Yes, I got insulted. What do you mean? Why do I go to church? What you mean? The Lord lives there. That's his house. We start defending it without thinking for a moment, like, why would he ask me that? Or what is it he's trying to tell me? We don't even want to hear stuff. You know, that's how we are. Especially when we think we know everything. And a lot of us think we know everything. That would make us God, right? And we're not. And so there's always something to learn. We are on a journey. So we are always learning something, right? And so when he presented it to me that way, I kind of felt like I was being attacked. And he was not even attacking me. But it's just some fleshy thing within us that we don't even want to hear anything that's not familiar to us, right? And so we close ourselves off. And he had given me a video to watch, and it took me weeks to watch it. I don't know why, but when I finally watched it, I was like, wow. And then I was like, no. Because I'm like, you can't possibly be telling me that everything we've been doing from learning in school and learning in church, that these things were incorrect. Like our whole lives are lies. Our lives are lies. Yes, indeed, it was the truth. We were living a lie. And it's time for us to start getting into the truth, the real truth, and searching for it and questioning stuff. Ask and ye shall receive. When we hear that scripture, we always thinking about things. We're so greedy and materialistic. Ask the Lord for the truth. Ask him for discernment. Ask him to wipe your eyes, wipe the scales off. Ask him to open your ears. Ask him to open your heart. Ask him for spiritual gifts and things so that he can show you. And stop being greedy, thinking about the things of this earth that are going to pass away. And when we die, we cannot take it. But I'm telling you, the stuff that we can pass down to our children, that's the real fortune. That's the real wealth right there. Spiritual wealth, nothing else beats it. That's the only thing that we can carry with us to eternity. The rest of this stuff is going to fade away. It don't mean a thing. It's an illusion to keep us distracted, to keep us focusing on being greedy and selfish and ungodly. Has nothing to do with the Most High God at all. And churches are teaching us that. Monetary gain. What? Is that what Christ was teaching when he came to the earth? Did he teach us how to get rich? Like some get rich scheme? Did he teach that? He didn't. Y'all know that. He didn't teach that. That's crap. That's garbage. that's secondary to spiritual things. If you want to be rich while you're here and you're doing it in a right way, there's nothing wrong with that to get wealth. But you need to know that that's not your goal. That's not your purpose in life. And if you're going to attain riches, you need to be doing something with that positively for the kingdom's sake, not just to be greedy and throwing money around talking about, oh, I got this, I got that, and buying stuff and doing ridiculous things with it. That's not what this life is. This life is ridiculous. If you get caught up into what Satan's throwing out there for us, you're going to definitely lose sight of the Most High God. And he actually infiltrated our churches, these buildings that we go into, under the traditions of these religions. Satan even crept in there even more. He, first of all, the foundation of it all was just wicked, but he's crept in there even more because it seemed like there was some type of goodness there at one point. Even in the mess that he created, he came into it and made it even worse. He's making so much things acceptable in these buildings and causing so much confusion. And even in Christ's day, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the scribes, these were all different types. These were all different Israelite camps and groups. And they had their own little stuff going on. And when Christ came, they could not stand him because he was the light. And he came telling the truth, the real truth. And that was stepping on their toes. And so even in today's world, nothing is new under the sun. So you have different Israelite camps teaching different things. People say, oh, you shouldn't get baptized. Some of them are saying they're coming back as Moses and just crazy stuff. Reincarnation. They're believing in the religions of this earth and they're doing those types of things. That always existed. The Bible is what we need to get into. It's our instruction. The Bible is not a white man's book. It's not. It was used to be taught to us incorrectly to confuse us. Churches are not, these different religions are not following the Bible. And if that Bible says Christ is the way to the Father, and you're dealing in a religion that does not acknowledge Christ as our Messiah and Savior, then that is a hell-bound message that is being taught as well. I just want us to just think about what we're doing and do not be offended. And if you are offended, let it be a righteous offending, if that's a term. Y'all know what I'm trying to say. Sometimes the truth hurts. So if it hurts, let it hurt and let it work for you, because we are hell-bound at the rate we're going. And I cannot sit on information. I keep saying, oh, I'm not going to say nothing this year. Every holiday, I keep saying something. And what am I backing down for? I'm not scared of y'all. I ain't scared of none of y'all. I'm scared to go to hell. And I'm scared to see the people I love go to hell. So I can't know information and just let me sit on it. I ain't telling these people nothing because they so hard-headed. They don't want to learn. Because I don't believe that about everybody. I was you. I am you. And I was in the same boat. And I didn't feel like